Macworld Podcast, episode 576 for October 5th, 2017. Hello and welcome to the Macworld Podcast. I'm senior editor Roman Loyola. I'm here with Macworld's managing editor Leah Yamshon.
Hello.
And in
Connecticut.
I am never going to get that right.
I was in Massachusetts last week.
I'm never going to get that right. Yeah. Is Macworld staff writer Michael Simon. Hello, Michael.
Hello.
And producing behind the desk, producing us today is our producer, Adam. Hello, Adam.
Hey, that's me, Adam. Murray. I'm in for the beautiful and illustrious Dan Masaoka.
Yeah, he's out today.
Yeah.
So, but we're here with Adam.
Yeah, here I am.
So, and we're live on Facebook and on Twitter. So thank you for joining us. If you have any questions or comments, please let us know. And Adam is monitoring those social sites, so he will chime in with your questions and comments whenever you have them. So please let us know. Today we're going to talk about the iPhone 8. We're going to talk about the Apple Watch Series 3. And then we're going to talk about an event that Google had yesterday. So we're going to start off with the iPhone 8. In particular, today we posted Leah's review of the iPhone 8. She's been working very hard.
Yay.
Since she got the phones.
It's a great review.
Oh, so thank you.
It's a terrific review. Please check it out if you haven't, if you're still making a decision on buying an iPhone. Leah has some very helpful information that you will need. So, Leah, the iPhone 8, what is your overall, I was trying to think of a more specific question, but so if I have, let's say I have an iPhone 7.
Okay.
And I'm trying to decide between the iPhone 8 and the iPhone 10.
Yeah, that's the $1,000 question.
Actually, yes. I think what we can do is go over all of the past iPhones and say, should I upgrade, yes or no?
So
and which one should I do?
I have the original iPhone. Should I upgrade to the iPhone 8? We'll start there.
Or the 10.
No.
Or the 10.
If you have the original iPhone, do not go for the 10 because there's going to be so much going on, you're not even going to know what to do with the 10. Like, stick with the 8. It at least
go
still
buy
has
a 3GS
like, go buy a 3GS. Just like slowly work your way up so that you're not like having, you know,
you need to acclimate
tech overload
yourself.
You too. You know, like they always say, like, jump right into a pool to adjust to the water. I'm going to suggest like dipping a toe in and then a foot and going slowly that way. No,
I think the iPhone X is going to be hard for us too. I mean, it's a pretty big change.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, these phones were kind of hard to review just because we know that there's something else coming.
Yeah.
So it's like I tried my best to just review these phones for what they actually are and trying to take a look at them as like the next step up from the 7. But then as I was doing that, it's like it seems boring if you just leave the 10 out of the equation. Because if you're just if this was like if we didn't have the 10, and if Apple released this product alone and they called it the iPhone 7S, it would be like, awesome, wow, this was like a sizable S upgrade. Like, it has the wireless charging, it has the glass back, it like has enough, you know, it has the True Tone display and the Retina HD screen. Like, that's a jump up from the 7. So it has enough newness to it that this would be a really exciting S release. I think it's like more exciting than your average S. But alone, it's not like if this came out and the 10 wasn't in the lineup and they called this the iPhone 8, it would be like, really? I mean, it looks the same. It will like my cases will fit. It still has the bezels. It still has a lot of the things that we like come to like know and expect from the iPhone. And all of these other Android manufacturers are like kind of doing some other things with their phones to like push the bar, you know, a bit, or raise the bar, excuse me. So yeah, these were kind of a tough batch of phones to evaluate. It is a definite step up from the 7, but I don't think it's enough of a jump up that if you have a 7 and if it still works great, I don't think you need the 8. If you're on the iPhone upgrade plan, like you might as well, I don't think the cost difference between the monthly plans for the 7 and the 8, I don't think it's that much of a difference. So if you're eligible for an upgrade, you might as well trade it in and get this phone. But if you're deciding between the 8 and the 10, you really just have to ask yourself, like, what it is that you like so much about your current phone. Because there is something to be said for the familiarity of it. Like, you can pick this phone up and you'll know, you know, exactly how it works. It still has the home button. It has a couple of like new exciting features that are going to be fun to like play around with, but there's no learning curve on it. And that's why so many people, I think, love the iPhone, is because, not to, you know, we say this so many times, but it you just pick it up and it just works. So, but if you're looking for something, if you're like feeling like you want something new, if you want a new experience in a phone without having to get an Android device, then the 10 is going to be for you. I think that's the best way to sum it up.
It's so hard to, as much as you want to review it in a vacuum, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
it's really hard because the iPhone 10 is such a significant different phone and you have to consider it. So maybe if price is a big consideration for you, maybe that makes it easier for you.
Mm-hmm.
There are also these rumors that there could be an even longer delay in terms of the iPhone 10 shipping. So there was...
They're saying the first round might not arrive till December.
Yeah. That's crazy.
There's a report by Brightwire, which I'm not familiar with them. So I don't know what they said, that there could be a delay.
But we've been hearing all along, even before it launched, that the reason why Apple didn't dive into OLED 3 years ago was because of yields, production yields.
Yeah.
It's not easy to make these in the mass quantities that they need.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And I think Apple might be a little bit surprised as to people kind of waiting on the iPhone 8. I think they expected people to rush out and buy the 8 like they always do.
Mm-hmm.
And a small group of people like us who really are, you know, on the cutting edge of technology and want the latest and greatest stuff and don't mind paying $1,000 for a phone are going to wait for the 10. But I think there's a lot of people who are waiting to see if they can get a 10, and B, maybe it is worth $1,000. Maybe I don't mind spending that much. So, well,
and anecdotally, at least the people I know in my life, you know, like I was like, oh yeah, most people are just going to be like, you know, but people were angry about how expensive it was. And I was like, okay, well, I bet the 8 is just going to do great and the 10 will just be for the real diehards. But instead, mm-hmm. I see this on the Android side too, where people are angry that it's so expensive, but they still want the best.
Yeah.
So they're waiting for the best.
Right.
But you know, we think it's going to be the best. It's being touted as the best, but we haven't actually used it yet.
Right.
And it's getting rid of some major features. Like, you know, I said this in my review, we freaked out over the loss of the headphone jack last year.
I still am.
I miss the headphone jack. I don't really use like lightning based headphones. I use the dongle if I'm using my wired headphones, and I have, you know, I use my AirPods the other time. So when I'm using the AirPods, it doesn't bother me. But when I go to plug in my stupid dongle and my like, you know, it's an annoying adjustment. The home button, this new gesture based like feature to replace the home button, it better be smooth. And I really hope Apple does. I mean, I'm sure they will. When you're turning your phone on, I'm sure there will be an instruction screen that will like tell you how to use these new gestures and everything. But that's going to be a hard one to get used to. I think Face ID will be really cool. I think maybe the novelty of it will like wear off after a couple of months, but as long as it works well, I see that as being like an okay Touch ID replacement. But I just think the home button for navigation, like people might have a hard time adjusting to that, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Well, and if I could chime in real quick, over on Twitter, we have a Chris B 1967. He says, he has a 6S right now.
Yes.
Though he's thinking of upgrading to the 8 Plus.
Okay.
And he's worried about, you know, losing the AirPods. He thinks they're way too easy to lose and doesn't like those.
I mean, I haven't had that problem, mm-hmm. and I'm pretty clumsy. But, I mean,
that's a concern.
That's a concern.
Yeah.
I mean, you can buy replacement ones.
Yeah.
But, you know, that cost can build up.
Mm-hmm.
And over on the same place, Paramonkey TV is asking, is the processor for the X and the 8, are they the same?
Yes, it's, yes. They are both going to use the A11 Bionic processor. And boy, is that thing fast. Wow. That was another, I didn't really talk about this. I talked about it in my review, but I haven't mentioned it here. Yeah, so it's... Last year's chip was called the A10 Fusion, and then this year's chip is the A11 Bionic. And we ran some Geekbench speed tests, and it's significantly faster. I have an iPhone 7 Plus, and I broke the screen on it maybe like 4 months ago. And when I brought it in for a replacement, they just gave me a new phone. And since I got that phone, I think that was a refurb, and it hasn't. I've had some problems with it. It's been a little sluggish. Like apps kind of freeze a bit. So I did the Geekbench tests on that phone, and like that phone was running really slowly. So comparing it to the 8 and 8 Plus was like, wow, these new phones are fast. So I looked at Geekbench, kind of has like an aggregate like site where they say like this is the average like speeds that you can expect from these phones, and even comparing the averages, which on average, the 7 Plus runs better than my personal 7 Plus. But the 8 and 8 Plus, like, both just smoke the 7. So if you're on, like, a 6S even, like, you'll notice the speed on the 8.
Nice and snappy.
Yeah.
But you also found, not just in the benchmarks, in terms of, like,
totally.
Using it
every day. You can tell in the speed. Like, Touch ID, it's just, like, boom, it's open, like, apps just load so quickly. They download really quickly if your connection is nice and strong. Like, I didn't experience any like freezing or kind of delay or any kind of stalling. Like, everything was just so smooth. And you can tell the difference in display too, like just the way that these apps look on the new phones. It's great. So I'm glad that even though we don't have OLED on these phones, and the iPhone 10 will have OLED, I'm glad that there has been some display improvements as well, so that we're not kind of feeling left in the dust. So,
I'm thinking one of the advantages of moving to OLED, at least on the Android side, is battery life. You know, like, how is the battery on these? And you know, the 10, I mean, we can probably expect even better. I don't know the size difference, but
Apple says 2 hours more. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So,
wow.
Yeah.
We'll see.
And on these phones, Apple's saying that it's comparable battery life to the 7 and 7 Plus. Again, since my 7 Plus has been having some issues, I have seen better battery life in the 8 and 8 Plus, even on like full days of heavy use. The Plus gets better battery life than the 8. But I typically, after days of like normal to heavy use, I still had a charge left at the end of the day, where my 7 Plus was dead.
Apple tends to, when it comes to speccing out their battery life, they tend to understate, I think.
So that people are pleasantly surprised.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a purposeful thing, or if the way they test battery life is maybe more tortuous than people's everyday usage. That's probably the case.
That probably makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
I wish they would put a 3,500 milliamp hour battery and get like a week of battery life. It drives me crazy that they're so optimized, but the batteries are small compared to Android phones because they can, because Apple controls the whole system and they don't need all that juice. Yeah. But if they put a huge battery in, it would last for like a week.
So the difference I have in approach from the 8 to the 10, the X, is if you buy into the 8 now, you're essentially buying the end, right?
Mm.
Going forward, they're probably not going to go with that design. It'll be all of the new design, right?
That's a good point. We don't know. Next year is going to be really interesting. I mean, that's a good theory. Yeah.
So I know some people like Dan, our other producer, you know, he was like, he's on a 5S, isn't that what he's on? You know, because he wants the smaller screen. Size. And he was like, you know, actually, I'm thinking of upgrading to a 6S, specifically because it still had a headphone jack.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so like he's like, I'm struggling with wanting to keep these legacy features around, but also he wants the newest thing,
sure.
You know. And then we have some people in the chat, like Ben Spires. He says he's not upgrading his phone until he can't upgrade the iOS version. You know, like I think people are really hanging on to these phones, and, you know, and keeping them around.
Yeah, well, that's good. Know? I mean, you don't have to get a new phone.
Yeah, I mean, they are $1,000. There's no reason to run out and buy a new one.
It still works. You know, there's no reason to upgrade.
Yeah, I think like most users probably do keep a phone around for at least 2 years, like two iPhone cycles, and then when it's time to swap out, then they figure out what's on the market there. And that's true. Like, you don't have to pick between the 8, 8 Plus, or 10. Like, the 7 is still available. The 7 is still a great phone. The 6S is, like, remarkably priced down. So if you want the headphone jack, 6S is a good phone, too.
And the SE is still around, isn't it?
SE is still around. That one hasn't been... Yeah,
it's a couple years now.
It's a couple years now.
It's the only small option.
It is the only small option. I mean, I don't know. I don't think the jump between the SE and the 6S is that, or the 8, like that size to me. It wasn't.
Well, if
too
Dan
crazy.
Were here, I'm going to channel Dan. Okay, he would argue that.
At the time, it was a big deal.
Yeah.
Now we look back now and it's not so much. But when they made that change and the 6 came out, it was big.
Yeah.
Comparatively.
When the 6 came out, that was the first year that we had a plus option. And I was like, yes, because I had been waiting for a big phone forever. So I've had a plus ever since the 6, and I've upgraded my phone every year, and testing the 8 was really funny at first. I was like, this thing is so small. And then I got used to it. And then I went to the 8 Plus and was like, oh, this phone is huge. So I don't know. But now I'm back with a plus as my daily driver. And I'm like, nope, this is the best size.
I went from the Note 8 to an iPhone 6. And it was I needed to lie down. Yeah.
So one interesting feature that I've noticed on the Android side, there are some people who actually miss bezels. Some people who are like, wait, why are people so excited about a bezel-less feature? Mm-hmm. Because they like being able to put their thumbs on the sides. Even Dan has mentioned that too. Yeah. I mean, I guess, could you see a possibility of going forward, they'll have a bezel feature and a full edge-to-edge? I mean, you know, not to jump too far ahead, but at the Google Pixel event, they had one that had bezels and one that didn't, you know, like... Could maybe they keep around both options?
I think when the 10 comes out, I could see Apple, like, I don't know, not that Apple really like takes its like public feedback into consideration, but right now one of the
on blast,
I'm just saying, like, people hated the headphone jack and they've like disappearing and they've like, you know, doubled down on that. But with the 10, you have the camera notch at the top, and that's going to drive a lot of people crazy. And if you had a little bezel up there, like, it would just be
just a little bit,
you know, a flat thing. So, I mean, there is a case, like, there are pros to having bezels for those reasons. I don't really mind having bezels on the iPhone, probably because I'm just so used to them.
Do you think you're going to miss them once they're gone?
I don't know.
Roman, what about you? You have larger hands like I do. Do you feel like, oh man, it'd be nice to still have a place to hold on to the front?
Well, I think what's going to happen is I'm going to end up putting my iPhone 10 in a case.
Mm.
So the case will end up acting as a bezel, so to speak.
Actually, do you think there'll be cases out there that add bezel?
Add a bezel.
Like specifically
add a bezel.
So.
Yeah, I think that's all happen for me. I mean, what's going to happen is Apple will keep the iPhone 8. They may even release an iPhone 8S next year.
Oh.
So that'll be the bezel
iPhone
line.
Classic.
That's the bezel
line.
I mean, the iPhone 6S is what, 3 years old now? 4 years old?
Three, I think.
Is it three? Yeah.
Three generations
the 6S is only 2 years old.
2 years old, but like three iPhone generations.
Yeah.
The 7 and the 8.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
so it's and that'll eventually drop out. I could see them doing an upgrade to the SE, similar to like how they upgraded the iPod Touch.
Mm-hmm.
Like
just
took,
like, oh, and we did this.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, we upgraded it. I know it's been like 5 years
on the
since
website.
We've upgraded it, but we've upgraded it. Because,
or the Mac Pro.
Right. And then, you know, the 8 eventually will become, you know, that's the bezel phone. That's the affordable phone. So the 8 down the line, the 8 will be there for a while. It'll be there for a while. And if you want a bezel, that's Apple's solution. You want a bezel? There's an iPhone.
Mike,
you want a headphone jack? It's the iPhone SE or iPhone 6.
Mike, you play in both worlds. Are you a bezel guy?
You know, it's funny. When you look at a phone without a bezel, it's gorgeous. Like the Galaxy S8 or the Note 8. But, you know, functionally, it doesn't really matter. Like once you get down to it, once you're actually sitting there and using it, like it doesn't matter how big your bezel are. You're just staring at the screen, you're using it. So, you know, like design-wise, the Note 8 is just gorgeous. And I think it looks better than the iPhone 8 Plus.
Do you think it looks better than the iPhone 10?
In pictures, no, but I need to see it. Like I'm not sold on the notch yet. I mean, we'll see. I need to, because a lot of times, you know, you look at these things online and in presentations, and then you see it in person, and it's like, oh wow, you know, like you, I need to hold and I need to see it. I need to feel the glass back and you know how thick it is, things like that. But I don't love that notch. I didn't like it when Essential released it. That's an Android phone. Essential has a little tiny notch at the top of their screen for the camera as well.
It's a real ugly notch. It's
kind of silly looking. But again, like once you start using it, all that stuff kind of disappears. Like you focus on the parts of the screen where your focus is, right. what you're looking at, and you're like the bezels and the notch and the buttons. Like none of that stuff matters functionally. So I think it's fine to keep small bezels. My favorite phone right now is the LG V30. Which kind of splits the difference between the iPhone 8 and the Note 8. There are bezels, but they're small, and you know, I don't have to worry about accidentally holding the side of the screen, and I can't touch it now because the side finger thing didn't activate properly. You know, having a little tiny bit to hold onto on the sides is fine. You know, I don't think it's a huge deal.
Yeah, where it really comes into play is when it's like in your pocket.
Yeah.
You know, how many times have we like seen somebody, you know, wearing a pair of jeans and you see this big giant triangle. I mean, there was that picture of Tim Cook when he was visiting, I think, a factory or something. And somebody like said, he must have the new iPhone. Cause look at the look at the rectangle in his pocket. And like you zoomed in and you see the rectangle and it wasn't as big as the iPhone 7
or 8, plus. Yeah.
Right? It was a little smaller, you know. So I mean, it all comes down to, you know, bezel-less is about carrying your phone in your pocket or in your purse or your backpack or wherever. That's what I really think.
Well, what I thought too. I thought on the Android side, it would be like, oh, you know, you can get smaller sizes, but still the same screen. I see it going the other way. They're keeping the size, but just adding
and
more screen.
Increasing the screen.
Unfortunately, I don't see too much of the benefit. I hope they circle back to that, but iPhones.
Yeah, the Note 8 has a 6.3-inch screen. It's massive.
It's huge. Huge. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, Aaliyah, you like big phones?
You should like
handle
that a
lot. The Note 8.
Yes, I would too.
Yeah.
So Leah, when you reviewed the phones, we actually wanted to post a review earlier, but then Apple went and released an update. So So you tested the phones so there's an 11.0.1 update, and then that came out last week, and then this week they released an 11.0.2 update, and you tested with both those updates.
Yes.
So.
The 11.0.2 update was supposed to address the crackly call issue. I wish I had I did not experience the crackly call, so I can't speak on like if this update actually fixed the problem, because I luckily like didn't experience the problem on either phones. Like call quality was as good as ever. In terms of like the benchmark tests, it was slightly better with 11.0.2, but not significantly better. I should have just posted both of those benchmarks to compare. That would have been interesting. But yeah, from what I saw, it offered like some speed improvements, but nothing like, you know, wow, that's amazing. And then was there another issue that 11.0.2 was supposed to work on?
I think it was
mostly the call, right?
It was mostly the call, some bug fixes. 11.0.1 was also mostly just bug fixes, mm-hmm. right? Yeah.
Yeah. Just kind of normal, like, cleanup.
Right.
I've been reading a lot of people on older phones, like, not necessarily the 7, but like the 6S or older. iOS 11 has not been running well on those phones.
Yeah.
My battery life is pretty terrible.
Yeah, I've seen.
On the 6.
On the 6? Yeah, I've seen battery life tanking on some people's phones, or people's phones just like constantly freezing or randomly restarting. I was like interacting on a Facebook thread with a friend from high school the other day who like had all of these problems and was so upset because she was like, I wish I could just go back to iOS 10, but Apple, I think yesterday, like released something where it's like, nope, no, no.
Yeah,
you can't go back. So that's such a bummer because she probably, and other people that have experienced these problems, could have gotten like more life out of their phone had they not upgraded. But it's so hard to tell how your device is going to react to the new updates.
There's a certain theory that says Apple does these things on purpose, so you will upgrade.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think they're necessarily doing it on purpose, but I mean, the A11 Bionic processor is obviously better and like able to handle more than whatever that was, the 6S, that's the A9. I can't remember if that one had a fancy name or not, but and iOS 11 is most likely optimized for the A11 chip, so it will work on older devices, but maybe not to its like full capability unless you're on the 8 or 8 plus or 10.
Fnomnal over in the chat says, yeah, it's been slow for him. And,
I have
a couple of friends who are on 6s, and they said battery life shot, and it's been getting warmer than usual. So
I've seen that too, where the particularly if it's updating apps or something, it will get warm. But like there are times when I'll look at my phone at like lunchtime and it says like 20%, like it's really bad.
Yeah, I mean, we do our best to, like, here at Macworld, we do our best to install the update on as many devices as we can and see how it works. But you know, your mileage is gonna vary, like depending on how long you've had your phone, how you use your phone. There are like so many variables. So it sucks that happened.
It does seem to be getting worse as the iOS matures, which is odd. Mm-hmm. Like you would think that it would run smoother as it gets more features, but then that's not the case. Like it used to be where you updated and it was fine. And it seems like with each succeeding iOS release, the older phones just get hit harder and harder.
Yeah, I find when I'm updating like whatever the like previous iPhone was, so like my 7, the 7 came out when iOS 10 came out, putting my 7 on iOS 11 wasn't really a big deal. So normally going like one iOS release up is fine. I found when you're going to like two releases, that's when you get like more of these issues of bugginess, but still, like that's not acceptable. These phones are expensive, and
the 6 is 3 generations. Yeah. So I mean, I kind of expected maybe it would be a little sluggish, but the battery life is just it's just horrible. Like I can't even really use it in public.
Yeah. Oh, that's a bummer.
That's my Apple Watch phone, essentially.
Oh shoot.
I just leave it home.
Oh, and then you can because of the LTE. That's right. So
yeah, there you go. Boom.
Yeah. Another thing real quick about speaking of the phones getting hot. Some people have reported that the phones get warm, the iPhone 8 and 8 Plus will get warm when you're using wireless charging. I didn't really experience anything that was like crazy warm or like, wow, that is remarkably hot, but they can get a little toasty towards the end of their charge cycle. I noticed that more on the 8 rather than the 8 Plus. The 8 Plus like stayed, you know, normal room temperature most of the time.
Well, that's good.
The 8 got like a little toasty, but again, it wasn't like my hands on fire. It wasn't like that kind of toasty. Right. And we also have not seen any issues of the swelling battery problem.
But is that really an issue, or is it just like, you know, a couple people out there?
Well, we'll see. I mean, the phone has only been out for 2 weeks and it's a couple people, and I don't mean to like, I don't want to like cause alarm or anything, but like the Samsung battery issue of last year, like kind of started with just a couple random people here.
Yeah,
and
but the Samsung was like literally exploding. These are just, well, like it's, and we haven't seen that yet.
Yeah.
And I actually went back and looked, and this time last year for the iPhone 7, same thing, a couple of scattered reports of, of battery swelling. I mean, it happens. And until there's a solution for lithium ion batteries, this is right. just a fact of life. This is what they do.
Yeah, I think maybe people are just more more worried about it because of the whole Samsung stuff.
That's
people
a good point. People are more weary.
And I think
about
that definitely fuels the headlines, absolutely.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
Well, one of the main reasons why you might want to upgrade from a 7 to an 8 is the camera.
It's the headphone jack. Oh, wait.
Sorry. Oh.
And the headphones.
Sit down.
Just kidding.
And earlier this week, we posted an article where Adam and Leah worked on a story on some camera comparisons. And Adam, who's a photographer as well as a podcast producer and video producer and just a jack of all trades, was you were actually kind of pretty impressed by the camera. Is that right?
Yeah, I did a couple stories. Well, I'm working on another story. But yeah, this one was specifically, hey, you know, let's take the iPhone 7 Plus, which, you know, we have around, compare it to the 8 Plus, you know, and kind of see if there's a huge upgrade. Because, I mean, to tell you the truth, I haven't been wowed by, you know, iPhones of recent. But this one was a huge upgrade. You know, definitely go check out the video because that's where I really dig into it. We had we hired a model, Valeria. She was very great to work with, and you know, we went through a bunch of different tests of color and clarity, even the portrait mode and the new portrait lighting stuff. So yeah, we kind of dug into it, and I was surprised. I was very surprised by like how much was different, and I think a lot of it comes down to the new ISP they had in the chip. You know, it was kind of their own custom made ISP, which, you know, allows them to take the photo and, you know, kind of process it in a way that's like, oh, here, you know, here's where the natural colors should be. Here's how we take multiple exposures and kind of stitch them together for the most clarity. You know, they did have new lens color filters and such like that. But yeah, I think a lot of it was just down to computational, you know, powerhouse. Yeah, I was pleased with it. Well, what about you? You went to Disneyland and used it.
Yeah.
Leah, what do you think?
I mean, I used it there and I used it just, you know, random shots throughout my testing and stuff. And I've had the 7 Plus for a year. I think that camera is great. So I was like, I mean, just looking at the specs between the 7 Plus and the 8 Plus, spec-wise, like, it's pretty much the same.
As almost any phone at this point, yeah.
But Adam, you said they upgraded, it's like Sony lens or process, what was
yeah,
the Sony fix there?
It's a new Sony processor mm-hmm. that has like, they called it deeper pixels, you know, which is a buzzword, but you know, they're essentially letting more light in. It's more sensitive to light and color, you know, but I think it's that, but I think, you know, a lot of it is the computational side, you know, the more they know how to kind of stitch these photos together, because it's not just one shot anymore. They're taking multiple shots.
Right.
They're stitching together stuff. You know, HDR is kind of, you know, a word that gets thrown around, but at the same time, that's kind of what all of the camera phones do now, that stitch together multiple shots of information. So, yeah.
So in my like unprofessional, untrained eye, I like was like, I don't even know if I'll really be able to tell the difference in my shots, but like I could. So, and it wasn't anything that made me be like, wow, the 7 Plus, like that camera sucks. It's just that like on the 8 Plus, things are a little bit more vibrant. You can just see a little bit more detail because of the A11 processor. Like you could take photos at a much like, things were firing at a quicker pace. Like things were, the autofocus was kicking in a little bit more efficiently than it did on the 7 Plus.
I mean, especially in low light, I found the autofocus like super quick, mm-hmm. You know, which is an advantage of the new chip, the new sensor as well. But yeah, I was like, wow, this is accurate and fast in real deep, you know, in real dark areas. Like,
yeah,
I was happy with that.
And you still get some level of like graininess and noise and stuff in low light environments.
At least, it happens.
Yeah, but it wasn't. It's only if you're like really zooming in are you going to notice that. So yeah, it's kind of unfair to compare the 8 Plus to the 8 in terms of like camera ability. The 8's camera is good.
Well, I mean, it's the same exact camera. It just doesn't have the second lens.
The second lens. So depending on the kind of photos you want to be taking with your phone, if you're just like a super casual photographer, the 8's going to be fine and you'll like the results that you have. If you are like a bit more serious about it, but you know, just want something that's not super on the professional level, but that's better, that offers a bit more like options than the standard, then the 8 Plus is a really, really, really great option.
Well, and I think a lot of people like being able to zoom in, you know, because a lot of people don't realize, hey, you know, when you take a photo with the 8, you know, and then kind of like pinch to zoom or whatever, you know, it's you're just taking all that information and expanding it. You're not really getting a better photo. So that's why you get a telephoto lens. It was funny. I had a, I went to a wedding, my stepsister's wedding a couple months ago, and I took a photo and my mom grabbed it and she, you know, I was like, hey, check out this great shot. And then she pinched a zoom and she's like, that would have been even better. I like photos like that, you know, essentially saying like, hey, I wished you would have zoomed in. So, you know, I think the zoom in is definitely, you know, a big step up for a lot of people. But I'm interested to hear, did you try the new Portra lighting
stuff? Oh, I sure did.
Yeah, and what do you think?
Not so great. I mean, it's okay. I think like you, it was like studio light and contour light were good depending on like certain settings, but not necessary. I didn't notice like a huge difference between just the natural portrait lighting and what these other two options offered. Cannot figure out when, like, because on the demo, when we saw the new portrait lighting features, the demo of stage light and studio light, which kind of like, how would you best describe that?
It's like it's the black background. Stage light kind of. And stage light mono. Yeah, it's essentially saying, hey, you know, you're putting a spotlight on somebody and everything else is black, you know, as if they were on a stage and you just want everyone to focus on that. I kind of did the same thing. I looked at Apple's YouTube channel and they had some videos like, you know, showing off, oh, well, here's some cool people doing some cool stuff with this stuff. And I was just like, those were like, well, number one, the model had real short hair. You know, because you know they didn't want to show that off.
You mentioned that the portrait modes struggle with hair, right?
I mean, they always have, okay. And they always will. I think.
So that's why the short haired bottle, like
yeah. So that's
an important thing to point out.
So
okay.
That and then the they were switching to the it was you know a guy and a girl taking photos on the street, you know, and just having fun, and he switched over to the stage light. You know, and you could see it in real time, obviously. And, you know, it's like, okay, in that situation, it looked good. But in my testing, and it sounds like yours, every kind of lighting, every kind of situation I tried to throw at it, it all just looked like a big joke. Every time I saw it, I was like, what?
It was just really cheesy. People's faces were often just like too washed out. it would crop around the face, but if like someone's hand was in the way, there would sometimes be some of the background would still like kind of be there that didn't quite get like faded out.
Well, and especially if you have hair and it's having a hard time distinguish between what's the background and what should be black and what's what you're focusing on and should be in focus, then the hair, you know, is just in this weird area where either it blacks it out and makes it look like you have like a, you know, an indent on your head, or you still see color and, or, you know what I mean, stuff from the background tangled within the hair. So it's, I like what they're doing. You know, they're taking all that information and having fun with it. But at the same time, like this was not, I was like, come on, guys. Like, I expect a little more.
We will say for now, it is in beta. Yeah. So it is a work in progress.
Well, but that's what they said about the portrait mode. And even though that was in beta, that was great.
Yeah.
You know, like I didn't see too many changes from beta to actual release.
It's just gotten like a bit more like accurate at figuring out what to focus on right away, I think, and blurring out the background.
Well, not just that, but also like they added in a couple features, you know what I mean, of like being able to save both the photos and, you know what I mean, like there's they added a couple little tweaks in that department. So
I love just the regular, like the natural light on portrait mode. So where you find all of these things, if you have the 8 Plus and you launch your camera app, if you're going through the different like options for capturing video and photo at the bottom of the screen, stop on portrait and then a little wheel will pop up with all of your different options. So natural light is the what is the like standard portrait mode, and then you have all of these other like lighting options to choose from. Yeah, the natural light portrait mode option is great. So
I love it.
I didn't maybe I'll add it in. I didn't post these photos because I did some like test engagement photos for two of my friends that just got engaged and we were at Disneyland. Aww. So I took some super cheesy photos of them like in front of the castle and just around the park. And they were so happy with how those photos turned out. They were like astonished that an iPhone could do that. They looked like, and listen, I am not a photographer.
Yes,
I just
are.
Want my things to look good now for my are. Insta stories. Like I don't care about any of these things. And I was, you know, I was really happy with how they turned out, and they were like just blown away. They looked like professional. So,
well, the portrait lighting, that you can't do that after the fact, right? That's you have to select which one you want before you snap the photo.
You can actually.
You can. Yeah.
Oh, you can.
You
can
work with any of them in real time. And that might help you. Like if you really want to play around with stage light or stage light mono, it would probably help to be using that one in real time so you can see what it looks like. But you can apply any of these after the fact.
Well, and save multiple versions. Mm-hmm. It was really nice. We have a question in chat. Sorry, I'm having a problem over here, so I don't see the guy's name. But he's asking about video improvements. I didn't really test the video. Dan does a lot of our video testing, but he didn't get a chance to do it with this one. I mean, iPhones have always been, great at video, good stabilization.
Yep.
Like I don't see anything too different. If anything, you're going to see the improvements in color accuracy and stuff like that on the video side as well. So,
and it can now capture 4K video. So if you have a...
It never...
I think last... Did it... Well, was 4K it, new last
it's,
year?
It's 60 frames per second.
Right.
The high frame rate 4K. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. The frame rate has changed.
Yeah, I shot a couple of videos, but I mean, yeah, like the stabilization is still great. That was new, or that came out with the 7 Plus, I think, or they had made some improvements last year that are similar to this year's. The slow-mo feature is really fun. Mm-hmm. You just like record a video in slow motion and then it picks the part to like highlight in slow-mo, so it plays back to you regular and then kind of like slows down in certain parts.
Yeah, it's cool.
It's great from what I saw.
Does the portrait mode work on the FaceTime camera?
No.
Or is it only the...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
That's the last thing I'll say about this stuff is that I want to call Apple out on gating hardware, gating hardware features for different size phones. There's people who want a smaller phone, but still want a dual lens system.
Yeah.
Or they're, to have only OIS in the iPhone X on the telephoto lens is BS.
Yeah.
Also, the dual lens setup is only on the 10. So you can do portrait mode on the 10, but you can't on none of the 8. So to delineate all of those features and say, oh, no, this is only for the upgraded people.
Yeah.
Guess what? Some people want a smaller phone, but they still want the awesome features. Like that is unacceptable and always has been. Like they should be on parity.
Hear, hear.
Yeah.
And especially now that we have, it kind of made sense last year with the 7 because it was like the 7 Plus was the premium phone and then the 7 was the intro phone. But now that we have the 10, which is the premium phone, like why couldn't you at least like even things out between the 8 and the 8 Plus a bit more?
Well, but I mean it's not a premium thing. People want smaller phones, but they still want it to be premium, right? Like I think that's a horrible argument, because It's not. I don't think it's just a premium thing. It should be, hey, no, all these phones are going to have all the awesome features. The only difference is going to be the size. You pick the size. All the features are the same.
Yeah, and why does a big screen equal premium?
That's true.
There's just no reason.
Maybe that's why, because of the price difference, maybe Apple is like, well, we'll give the Plus some extra features to justify the big price difference. I don't know. This is all speculation, but I agree that the smaller phone should
give the small phone some love.
Yeah.
Give the small phone some love, especially in the portrait mode. I mean, I love doing the portrait mode stuff.
It's fun. It's awesome. It's really fun.
So
our Leia's review of the iPhone 8 and the 8 Plus is up on the Macworld site right now.
Go check it out.
And check out Adam's camera shootout between the 7 Plus and the 8 Plus.
Nah. Everybody on YouTube saying I don't know what I'm talking about, so don't worry about it.
We also have an article that compares the specs between the iPhone 8 and the iPhone 10, and if anyone's interested in still making a buying decision.
One question for Adam.
Hey, that's me.
How does it compare to the LG G6, which is your favorite smartphone camera in the whole entire world?
Oh, I can't tell you. I can't tell you that. I'm still working on the article on that one. But I'll say, I like this phone. I had a hard time. I'm an Android guy, and I'll never go back to iOS. But man. I really like this camera. Nah, can't do it.
Well, we'll have that article.
Yeah, that article will also be listed on Macworld, but it's going to be
for that. Yeah. But moving on, if anyone is interested, well, I'm sure there are. But Mike Simon's been working on a Apple Watch Series 3 review, which will actually post tomorrow, I think. So be on the lookout for that.
Yeah.
And Apple released an update to Watch OS. Mike, can you tell us a little bit about the update?
Yeah, this is the one we've all been waiting for since we read the first round of Apple Watch Series 3 reviews. This fixes the problem with the watch trying to connect to unauthenticated Wi-Fi networks.
Yay!
So it doesn't stop your watch from connecting into LTE. I solved that problem when I first got the watch by clearing my iPhone network preferences and going to my Mac and getting rid of a bunch of networks. So I can't speak to whether or not it'll solve that problem for people who hadn't done that. But I will say that I had a couple of small issues. One was when I would leave my house and I was on a call, switching to my watch, which is probably something you wouldn't do all that often, but it would persistently drop the call, and then I'd have to reinitiate the call once I left my Wi-Fi and cooked up to LTE. It does not fix that. That I tried that out this morning, and that was still an issue. And the other issue I have is when I have one bar on my phone, areas that I know are really poor service in my neighborhood, my watch just drops it like it doesn't hang on, and I tried that too, and it didn't fix that as well. So there's still a couple of nagging issues with LTE that this update doesn't fix. But this is a 4.0.1 update, so it's specifically for that one issue.
Yeah.
So if you have other things, it's probably not going to clear those things up until 4.1.
Mike, I only have one question concerning the Apple Watch review. When you were taking phone calls, yes or no, did you feel like Dick Tracy?
A little bit, yeah. I did use headphones a lot, but when I use my wrist, yeah, I mean, it's hard not to, particularly when you know your phone's not there. It's pretty cool. I really like the Apple Watch Series 3, as you'll read tomorrow. Like I said, a couple of issues with LTE. It's not perfect, but I understand it's a Gen A product. This will improve, but this is in my mind, where this is the first real independent Apple Watch. This is the device that Apple wanted to release from the beginning.
You mean you can set it up without a phone or a computer?
You can you do need a phone.
So it's not truly independent then.
It's independent once you get
the once you set it up.
Hey, that was a big thing when they said you could activate an iPhone without a computer. I remember that was a big thing.
PC-free, they called it.
Yeah, I'm waiting for the watch that doesn't have to activate with a phone, and then I'll buy one.
You also have to install apps on the phone. You absolutely need to have a phone. But it's much more of an independent device than it was previously, and you can use it for long stretches with your phone being nowhere near you.
Nice.
So yeah, tomorrow, Mike's review, will post that tomorrow, so be on the lookout for that.
There is no camera shootout though. Sorry,
we don't have a camera shootout for that one. So. But yeah, be on the lookout for Mike's review. If you have any comments or questions about the Apple Watch Series 3, let us know on Facebook and on Twitter.
I have an interesting, a quick little aside story.
Sure.
I bought my dad a gold Apple Watch, not the edition, like the gold colored Apple Watch when he retired last February.
That's nice of you.
Yeah, thank you. So earlier this year, he calls me up and he says, my watch won't, I can't get it to work. So he brought it up to when he visited, and I checked it out, and I told him it was, he was stuck in a loop where, the Apple symbol kept showing and it wouldn't get out of that loop. And eventually the battery just died and it wouldn't charge. He finally took it to an Apple store last week, and they told him it was a software issue and that they would fix it for him. And 2 days later, they called and they said it was ready. So we showed up to pick it up and they said, okay, that'll be $200.
What?
And he said, what do you mean? And they said, well, we looked at it and it's not a hardware issue. I mean, I'm sorry, it's not a software issue. It was a hardware issue. So we gave you a new watch and there's a $200 charge for that.
Whoa.
And yeah. So thankfully he was, persistent enough. And he said, well, I'm not paying $200. And I also want my watch back because it was a gift from my son.
Yeah.
And so they talked to a manager and they said, okay, we'll just give it to you. Just take it. And, no charge. And, two things about that. One, it's a little messed up that they didn't call him and tell him.
Yeah, that's very
unhelpful.
But number two, kudos to Apple for taking care of it and not keep making a whole scene out of it and not charging him the money and giving him his watch. And, there are other stores that would have been, no, you're not, we're not giving it to you unless you pay us. So, mm-hmm. At least they took care of it.
Whoa.
Wow.
And does he like it? Is it working well now?
Yeah, he installed watchOS 4 and he loves the Pixar face.
So yes. He's nice. Your dad should hang out.
But that's actually a good moral of the story is when it comes to Apple support and Apple service.
Never let down.
Don't let down. Eventually, I've heard more stories than not of them actually relenting and letting the consumer. They're more interested in making the consumer happy.
Oh, good.
But yeah, that kind of service bait and switch, that's not.
Yeah.
That's not cool.
They should have called and said, hey, we found the problem. It's this.
Right. Yeah. Can buy a new watch for $250, better than the one that he has.
Yeah.
For $200, because his is a Series Zero, because it was at the time. So it's not even the new processor.
I don't think it's Series Zero, because the gold wasn't an option when it first came out.
Oh, was it? Did
so
I
it
get
been series,
series
One?
Maybe I did.
Yeah.
I might have. You might be right.
I would have absolutely gotten a gold one if that was available when I bought my Series Zero. So.
Okay, maybe it was a Series 1, but still, he could have gotten, maybe for another $100, got a Series 3,
Right.
$200 is a lot to pay for a watch that's a couple years old.
Yeah.
Well, that's some good advice. Thanks for bringing that up.
So, be persistent if they try to
charge. Be persistent at the Apple Store. Get what you want. So. But moving on. There was actually a Google event yesterday.
Great to see you. Yeah, we'll see you later.
On the Macworld podcast, we're going to talk about Google. And I wanted to bring it up because it was an interesting event. This was, for those of you who don't know, Google had an event yesterday. And Mike Simon was very much involved in the coverage of that event.
Was there.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And Adam was there, too. He was shooting video. So, just wondering what you guys thought of the event. So Adam, what was the main takeaway of this particular event for you? What was the big reveal, the big thing that made an impression on you?
I'd say the biggest thing other than AI, like whatever, they've been pushing this whole, you know, AI first thing for a while, but I think they're finally getting on like a design parity, you know, where, hey, they've got, you know, a handful of different kind of product lines between a Chromebook and a home speakers and phones and stuff like that, and they're all, the design feels like they all fit together, which is nice. You know, it's like a one big family that they're kind of like trying to push. So I liked that. What about you, Mike?
What I thought was interesting was speaking of design, that, you know, Google doesn't seem to be focusing on the outward appearance of its products as much as Apple, like mm-hmm. not anywhere near as much. I mean, the Pixel 2 is a nice phone, but there's big chunky bezels, and even on the Pixel XL, you know, it's not the the Galaxy S8 Plus by any stretch. There's no Infinity display. It's a nice phone. What Google is really doing is focusing on the internals, and most importantly, the software. And it struck me just how far ahead of Apple it is with AI and with machine learning. I mean, the Google Assistant and these products, it can do things that Siri cannot even come close to doing. That demo that they showed of the earbuds translating in real time was just like mind blowing.
That was really cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Siri can't even come close to doing that.
Yeah, just for the audience who didn't pay attention to the Google event, so Google have their own wireless. They're not true wireless because there's a wire connecting the two earbuds, but they have their own.
Well, it's just cloth.
Right.
Yeah.
They're called Pixel Buds.
Yeah.
They're the same price as AirPods.
Yeah. So they have their own wireless AirPods. And then, but the demo that they showed was basically doing translation between one person speaking English and another person. Was she speaking Swedish?
I don't remember.
But yeah, she wasn't speaking English. So she basically used the Google earphones.
Pixel Buds.
Well, I actually don't think it's Pixel Buds. I think it's just Google Buds, isn't it?
Did they have the Pixel moniker?
Yeah.
Google See, Pixel. I think it's. Hold on, let me look.
Yeah.
Anyways,
yeah,
they used the Google
Pixel Buds.
Google Buds, you know, to hear the other person speak and then provide a translation through the phone. And then the person would speak. The Google Buds would hear it and then provide a translation for the other person to hear. So it was really slick, and it made me kind of go, that should have been what the AirPod demo was.
Yeah.
You know, but Apple's so into their music thing that they kind of, to me, that when AirPods came out, I was kind of like, all right, yeah, it's wireless AirPods, you know, but Apple should have done, and this is what Apple should be doing. And it made me kind of go, oh, that's where the puck is now, because Apple always uses metaphors, skating to the puck. They even mentioned it in their last event. And the puck, I think Apple is misdirected as to where the puck is now.
Hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The puck is somewhere else, and Apple thinks it's over here, but it's really way over there, and Google's closer to that puck than Apple.
Well, because, I think Apple, you know, I was trying to describe to a friend yesterday, you know, where Google's really focusing on AI and software, machine learning. You know, Apple's still very much in the material design and product based kind of stuff. You know, and funny side back on the design stuff. I can't remember who I was watching. It was somebody's coverage on YouTube was saying like the Pixel line and family design is kind of feels like I can't think of the word utilitarian. Is that a word?
Yeah.
And it feels like the IKEA design of phones, very, you know, basic and you know, nothing special. But yeah, I think it's two different approaches, and and they even showed it in the photography. You know, they're saying, hey, we're going to do one lens, but because we can do all this computational stuff on the back end, it's gonna make up in software what other people are trying to do in hardware. You know, my hands-on little thing that we did over on PC World, it wasn't mine. I did it with John Phillips, our editor-in-chief. You know, it wasn't quite there yet. I know the phone hasn't been released, but, you know, like, Yeah, there's something to it, but sometimes, you know, hardware needs to be there, you know, like it needs to be a mixture of both. I don't think either one of them can stand out without the other. But also I don't think either company has got that perfect mixture yet.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because Google in many ways is trying to do what Apple does, you know, it wants to create its own ecosystem. It's creating its own line of products because it sees that Apple has a great amount of success at doing that. At the same time, they have this own thing. You know, they have a huge advantage because of Google, you know, because of the search. So they gather all this data. They can create, they can do work on AI and things like that. So they have a huge advantage where Apple has to do other things to get there, to do their AR research, to do their AI research. So it's a little bit of a different challenge. You know, Apple gets criticized a lot on a different train of thought. Apple, the design of the iPhones have been kind of criticized because they're getting a little long in the tooth. And, you know, the iPhone X has sort of been sort of this new design, a way of new design. And that's even been criticized a little bit because of the notch or whatever. And one of the ways you can kind of overcome some of these design flaws is with software, you know? And has iOS progressed as much as maybe we would like it to, or even Apple has liked it to? I don't know. You know, I know Siri hasn't. I know Siri, because I've written about how much I've struggled with Siri. You know, like in my Hi Sierra review, I always talk about how Siri misunderstands me a lot. And for the longest time, I always thought, it's my fault. And then yesterday when I saw this demo, I thought, well, maybe it's not my fault. Maybe it's Siri, you know, maybe it is more Siri's fault. Maybe it's more Apple's fault, you know, that they're not doing enough work on things like Siri and other aspects of their software to make their products feel more advanced and to overcome some of the criticisms that, and maybe they don't care about the criticisms. They really don't care, but go ahead, Mike.
But then again, we were saying that about AR 6 months ago, and then they dropped ARKit and just blew our minds.
Yeah.
Apple does a lot of work when not watching.
Apple's not as transparent as Google. Yeah.
Google does a lot of its iterating in public, and they'll release, you know, small updates to Assistant. And maybe Apple is working on this massive Siri machine learning neural upgrade that we'll see next year.
Yeah.
And we'll say, okay, fine. Now they're on. All of a sudden, it's a level playing field.
Or maybe in time for the HomePod's release.
Maybe that too.
That would be like, that's so soon that probably not. But that would be quite the surprise.
Yeah, it's a little surprising that we haven't heard much about Siri in a while from Apple. Right. Like, there's nothing new. It does the same things that it did.
Well, it has a new voice.
Yeah, new voice, like maybe slightly faster, but in terms of like what it can
just capabilities. I mean, Google showed off those routines where you can just say, hey Google, good night, and it turns on your motion camera, it shuts off your lights, it sets your alarm. Like that's
and your Nest thermostat.
That's next level stuff.
Yeah. My bet is that Siri needs to move forward once they start doing this home stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because that to be able to you know, do the natural dictation when it's on your phone and it's right there, or with your headset, you know, or even your Mac, it's right there. But you know, like a lot of times I'm still blown away when either I'm talking to Alexa or my Google Home, you know, from 20 feet away, and it can hear me clearly, you know, and understand, you know, what I want to do, like things like that. You know, like it needs to push forward when it's going to try to really go into your home.
Well, speaking of Google Home, Google showed yesterday a direct competitor to the HomePod.
Yeah.
Which is
the more expensive competitor to the HomePod.
Right. Is it Google Home Max? Is that what they call it?
Max. Yeah. Kind of a weird name, but
it's a weird name.
Yeah. So this is
also a video of Diplo hanging out with his friends.
Right. So the Max is what makes it Max, I guess, is that it's more, it competes with like Sonos as well and these other home audio systems where it's supposed to offer, it's built for playing music and it's supposed to offer, you know, this great quality sound that, you know, designed to fill a room and things like that, which is what the HomePod was its angle. that it was, you know, a speaker that also happened to be a digital assistant.
I'll say one little thing that I liked when I saw it was that you can put them in stereo pairs. You know, so they were like, oh, hey, you could either have one or you can set them up in a stereo
pair. It'll cost
pair.
You $800.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah.
You can do it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, well, that's the thing. You know, it's $399. It's $50 more than the HomePod. When the HomePod was announced, people were complaining about the price because they were putting it in this perspective of, well, this is what Google Home costs and this is what Alexa costs.
Yeah. But really, I mean, it's competing, like you said, with Sonos and other home theater setups.
Sonos came out with a $200 speaker yesterday that does Alexa now and will do Assistant and Siri in the future. So that's kind of, you know, merging all of them into one.
I mean,
and Sonos is, you know, I have a whole Sonos system and their sound quality is unsurpassed.
Yeah, my parents got a Sonos system and they're not too techy, but they love being able to control it and do the
Sonos
stuff.
Sonos is kind of the Apple of the home theater. I mean, it's awesome how easy it is and how great it sounds.
Yeah, my guess is that all these companies are going to have a real hard time keeping up with Sonos, you know, especially if people are already invested.
$200,
Yeah.
Yeah, so there was that. There was the, and they also came out with, what was the other version of the Home? The smaller version?
The Home Mini.
Which they gave everyone at the event, too. So I got to take one home. I set it up in my bathroom because now I have three Home Assistants, but I was missing one in my bathroom for listening to music. So,
okay, yeah. Google, buy toilet paper.
Yeah, right.
Can he hear you in the shower if you're like, change songs?
I haven't tried that yet. I did not shower last night. Spoiler.
Gross.
But, you know, I got to say the audio quality on those small kind of puck devices are... I mean, I like that it's there and it's an option, like a small option if you need it. But
that's for the assistant. It's more assistant focused.
I like that. I use my home stuff for music for most of the time. And I like the bigger guys because they have far superior sound systems. So,
and then there was the Pixel 2. And Mike, what did you think about the Pixel 2?
The original Pixel is, you know, still a year later, one of the best Android phones you can buy. And the main reason is because of it has an iOS like level of integration with Android that you don't get on any other phone, really. I mean, Samsung and LG, and they all kind of put their twist on Android and they do their best, but Google controls the end-to-end experience. So the Pixel 2, you know, I haven't used one yet, but it looks as though it's like iOS and the iPhone. It's Android Oreo. It has cool new features that are exclusive to the Pixel. It has a new launcher with some new stuff. And Google is basically saying, listen, if you want the best possible Android experience, this is the phone you need to get. What's interesting is that it's not like a pretty phone, for the lack of a better word. It's an okay phone.
It's fine.
It's
the IKEA of phones.
Yeah, it does. It's not gonna blow you away when you walk into a store and pick one up like the Galaxy S8 Plus did. But it's a nice enough phone. The screen looks great, and it's packed with, you know, a bunch of cool stuff that you know, and it's gonna get great battery life, and you know, it will sell. I don't think it's going to sell like Google wants it to still, because A, it's tied to Verizon, and B, they're probably going to have trouble making
Verizon
them again.
Well, they do have an unlocked
version.
Oh,
right.
That's so annoying. Why are they doing that?
I bet Verizon's paying.
Pays them a bunch of money.
All right. I was, you know, wondering if there was some
performance or something
something
tied to their network.
Yeah, so is there a big price difference between what Verizon sells it for and then if you buy it unlocked?
I mean, Verizon right now is like giving discounts if you trade in and stuff that, where, you know, the unlocked you're not.
But Google has their own.
So, you know, you can get different deals.
Okay. What was the pricing on the Pixel 2?
It's
$650,
$650 and
$850. Yeah.
64 gigs it starts at.
So
what's the higher capacity?
128 for $100 more.
Okay.
So it's still, you know, if you buy 128 Pixel 2 XL, it's $950. It's not a cheap phone at all.
But they gave a great dig at Apple yesterday because in their mind, storage isn't as big of a deal because they're offering free unlimited photo and video storage in their Google Photos cloud, which I use, and it's amazing.
And it's the original quality. It's not compressed at all.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Original quality, not compressed, as many copies as you want. And they had a little sizzle reel where, you know, people were out, like, you know, shooting photos, shooting video, and then the music stopped and an iOS pop-up came up and said, your storage is full. And, like, right. You heard a guy be like, oh, and then they're like, never mind. You've got, you know, unlimited cloud storage. You don't need to worry about that.
I think they've used that commercial before. I missed
that
the
was
event
on the
yesterday.
The original Pixel 2.
Well, there was the shot of the girl taking a bite from an apple.
I didn't pick that up.
That was the Pixel, the little introduction video. Yeah. Another dig at Apple was when they said that we don't restrict hardware to a larger phone.
Yes.
You know, it's the exact same features other than the screen.
Except for the bezel thing, which, you know, I was like, wait, you're saying don't, you know, change the features, but the screen and the bezel is different on the smaller and the bigger one.
Yeah, the design's a little bit different.
Yeah. But yes, in terms of cameras, they're all the same. Yeah,
exactly the same.
Yeah, it was funny because they were at the same time, while they were digging at Apple, there were some things that were very Apple-esque, like at the end when they were showing the product family, and it looked like a Apple-type product shot of the product family. You know, there's Apple has similar shots of that all over their website.
Oh yeah.
And then there was at the end, I forget the guy's name, but he said, "Oh, and we have one more product."
Oh,
which was really the we have one more thing. Which was and the guy was wearing a black t-shirt.
He was actually, you're right.
So, and I was kind of like, "Oh, that's the one more thing." So, I saw all these like parallels to what Apple events and stuff. So, in a way, you know, at this while they're taking cues from Apple, at the same time they are attacking, you know, they're going after their market, and you know,
and you know, Apple does the same thing with Google. Let's be honest.
Apple does the
same. It's kind of fun. I kind of like it.
Yeah. No, it's fun. So, but it's interesting.
One interesting thing I noticed this morning was on Google's store site, the Android Watch is gone completely. Like it's not there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Huh.
They have their own products. And if you specifically go to the Android Wear site, if you even remember it, you can get there and nothing's in stock anymore. So I don't know if that means that Android Wear is gone, or if maybe a Pixel Watch is in the works at some point.
They would have announced it. They would have announced it.
I mean, certainly not this year. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Android Wear lovers, you might be in for a rocky ride going forward, because I don't know if Google's going to support it too much. Google has a habit of doing that where they just drop products for no really explainable reason.
We'll see.
Yeah. So if any of our viewers, listeners have any thoughts about anything we've talked about today, the iPhone 8, the Apple Watch Series 3, stuff that Google did yesterday, let us know in the Facebook comments and on Twitter. But I think that wraps it up for this week's show. I'd like to thank Adam, our producer.
Hey, I'm glad to be here, but you'll probably get Dan back next week. So, yeah.
And then Mike over in Connecticut.
Hello.
Like, thank you for joining.
Where is he?
I'll never get that right for some reason. And Leah, our managing editor, thank you very much. Thank you for doing the review. It was a great job.
Of course. Thank you, Roman.
And I'd like to thank the audience for your participation, for joining us today. Join us next week. Next week, we'll be at our regular time, which was Wednesdays at 10 o'clock Pacific, 1 o'clock Eastern time. So, again,
what about London?
London is 8 hours ahead of us.
I don't know.
So that is 6 o'clock.
Math sucks.
So, 6 o'clock in the UK, I believe if I'm correct. I believe they're 8 hours ahead of us. But anyways, next week we'll be on our regular time schedule. So that again, Wednesdays at 10 o'clock Pacific. Hope you can join us on Facebook and on Twitter. Thank you very much.
See ya.
Bye.